Hi, and welcome to the Assembly Line podcast. I'm Chris Torrance. In today's episode, I'm going to take another look at the 1.6 inch emulator from MFA2 Workshop and show you how to solder on the new battery connection to your lithium battery that you've purchased elsewhere. So let's get started. The emulators from MFA2 Workshop come in two varieties. Here I'm showing the 1.6 inch emulator. There's also a 3.2 inch larger emulator. Neither one of them comes with a battery, so you'll have to purchase that separately. The kit itself comes with everything that you see here. You get the 1.6 inch emulator. You also get a little dongle that you can plug a wired or a wireless adapter for a USB keyboard into that. Then you get a cable for charging your emulator, and this just plugs into any 5-volt power supply like an iPhone or Android. Finally, you get some instructions, and then you get the battery cable itself, which we're going to have to solder on. One thing that I mentioned in an earlier video is that the plugs on the emulator are actually the small version of the lithium ion battery plug. And if you buy a battery, it'll typically come with the larger plug. MFA2 Workshop has supplied a wire with the correct socket on it. So what you'll need to do is purchase your battery, then unsolder the plug from it and solder on the one that is supplied with your emulator. Speaking of batteries, you're going to want to buy a lithium ion battery to go with your emulator. I have a link on the store page for a recommended one. The one that I recommend has a 500 milliamp hour capacity, which gives you a few hours of runtime. In addition to the battery, you'll need a micro SD card, and I'd strongly recommend getting a name brand such as SanDisk, as these seem to work a lot better in these types of devices. Here I'm using an 8 GB one, which seems to work fine. To do the actual battery plug replacement, you'll need a soldering iron, and pretty much any soldering iron will do. I have one here that has a temperature control, but pretty much any soldering iron should work fine. Finally, you'll want a fan for fumes, and then optionally a wrist strap to guard against static electricity. Finally, I've got some solder, some flux cleaner, and then a brass sponge for cleaning off the tip of your soldering iron. Last but not least, you'll want some sort of keyboard so you can test out your emulator. Here I'm using a wireless keyboard, but a wired keyboard will work fine as well. The first thing I'm going to do is remove the emulator from the case. And this is actually just held in with tension. There's a little piece of PCB here that is a shim that's holding the whole thing together. The best way to remove it is just take some sort of tool and gently pry out in the corner, and then carefully also pry from the front. You need to make sure that you get the switch clear as well as the USB charging port. And it helps a little bit to actually kind of gently pull the case slightly apart at the top, which will let the plug come out just like this here. The last thing we want to remove is the battery cable, and to do this, just kind of get your fingernail into the socket and pull it straight out gently. Now we can put all these pieces over to the side. We won't need those anymore right now, and we can concentrate on desoldering the plug from our battery. One thing I forgot to mention, you might want to pick up a roll of Kapton tape. You could try to reuse the tape that's on the existing battery, but I sort of shredded it, as you can see right there. So it's always handy to have a roll of that on hand. You could also use electrical tape, but it just doesn't look nearly as nice and it's a little bit thicker. So now that we have the first layer of Kapton tape off, you should see the circuit board underneath, and you can just gently pry this back, and this will expose the two wires on the pads. And this is what we need to desolder. So let's get the last layer of Kapton tape off of the circuit board, and then we can go ahead and remove the old wires. Before removing the wires, just remember to check which wire is on the left and which one is on the right. So if in mine, for example, the red is on the left and the black is on the right. To desolder the wires, it doesn't really take much heat. What I'm going to do is gently pull on each wire as I apply the soldering iron, and this will provide a little bit of tension. So as soon as I heat up that pad, then it should just pop right off. So there is the red one, for example, and now we'll just move on to the black wire, just a little bit of heat, and we should just be able to pull it right off. The good thing is there's actually probably enough solder left over on the plug. We really won't need much solder, if at all, to attach the new wires. I'm going to feed the wires in the same direction as they were on the old plug, and then I'm just going to gently apply a little bit of heat first to the black wire, and you'll notice I didn't need to use any extra solder. There was plenty already on the pad. Once I've gotten the black one done, I can get the red wire into position and then go ahead and just apply a little bit of heat there. And assuming that there's enough solder, it should just stick with no problem at all. And just give it a gentle tug to make sure it has a firm connection. Finally, you can fold over the circuit board just like before, and then we'll want to wrap the whole thing up in Kapton tape. But before I do that, let's just plug it in and make sure it actually works, just in case we got the wires backwards or we didn't have a good solder connection. So you'll want to plug in the correct orientation. You can just check the direction of the prongs. If you look at the little tabs, you'll notice that they face towards the front, and this will tell you the correct way to plug it in. Just slide it in until it clicks in place, and then we can go ahead and we can plug in our charging cable. Here, I just have a 5-volt plug just plugged into a regular 5-volt charger that I have for my iPhone or for your Android. And I'm going to make sure when I plug it in that I actually have the power to the emulator turned off. You want to always have the power switch in the off position while you're charging. Otherwise, the charger will go straight into the emulator and could damage it. The emulator will actually turn on while it's charging, but nevertheless, you still want to keep the switch in the off position. If the emulator doesn't turn on when you plug in the power adapter, then that probably means that you just have the wires reversed on your battery. You could either just desolder them, or if you're very careful, you can just lift up the little tabs on the small plug and just flip the wires. All right, so now that we've verified that our battery is charging correctly, let's go ahead and we'll take a small piece of Kapton tape and just cover up that circuit board so it doesn't touch anything inside the emulator. I'm going to cut off about a 2-inch piece of Kapton tape, that should be plenty, and then I'll just stick it onto the emulator and just wrap it around and fold it over just to keep everything nice and neat. Now that we've got the battery all done, let's go ahead and reassemble everything. I've got my case here, and just make sure that you orient it so that the USB port and the plug are in the correct orientation, and then just slip it in the same way that it came out before. And the best way to do this is to put the switch in first to make sure that that has enough clearance, and then gently press in the rest of the assembly. Once you have it in there, you can go ahead and take that little PCB shim and just tuck it into the bottom to keep everything secure. Depending upon the thickness of the battery that you bought, you may or may not be able to completely close the case. Here, I've chosen a battery which has a 5mm thickness, which I think unfortunately is a little bit thick for this case. And you can see here that while the battery actually fits in, unfortunately the speaker itself is not going to quite fit. So my case isn't going to quite close. The probably best fix for this would be to just get another battery that's a little bit thinner, or maybe if you have a 3D printer, you could just print another case for yourself. Now that we've got it more or less assembled, I'm going to plug everything in. So first I'll take my keyboard dongle that comes with my emulator. I'll plug in the USB wireless adapter there, plug that into the USB port. Then I'll take my SD card, which has already been preloaded with a whole bunch of games, and I'll put that into the micro SD slot, just like that, and make sure to orient it the correct direction. I think the little teeth on the SD card face the front of the emulator. Let's flip the switch on. And here we can see Total Replay is coming up in the emulator. So even though we only charge the battery for a few minutes, that's enough to just get it going and test things. I'll turn on my wireless keyboard and let's see if we can actually start playing something. So here I'll just type K-A-R to bring up Karateka. And we see that the game starts and everything sounds great. Just another reminder that when you're charging the 1.6 inch emulator to keep the switch in the off position so that you're not running the power into the emulator. The 3.2 inch emulator doesn't actually have this issue because it has a separate USB port for the keyboard. So you don't have to worry about running the power through that at the same time that you're charging. And you can actually use it while you're charging. I hope you enjoyed this quick tutorial about how to solder the battery cable onto your emulator. If you don't have one of these kits and want one, you can go to my website and get yourself on the mailing list to be notified when they're back in stock. Once again, thanks for watching my videos. I have a Patreon if you're interested in supporting me that way. Otherwise, please hit the subscribe button below. Thanks for watching.